Hey guys, guess what? I'm back. Grab onto your joysticks. It's time to get ready.
For another episode of the Words Are Hard podcast, we're back today talking about Vigima Games.
Oh, what a surprise.
Specifically, I want to bring up, I guess, what game has influenced you the most in your life? Because
now or earlier in my life?
Whatever your preference is. I guess, it sounds kind of bad, but mine personally was Minecraft. Reason I say that is that that's the first game that I got into, like, a proper gaming community with. And it's, I spent, a good 2 to 3 years talking to the same people online, getting to know them, through this cubed world. And, sure, there was the odd forum post with our pictures on it and stuff, but it's the first time I got to, like, interact with people online in a community, like, in a proper community.
That's weird. I never got that out of that game. I built some stone penises. And
yeah, I tend to play it by myself or just with my wife. I didn't really play a lot on
server. Well, I mean, we played with your wife probably more than you did.
Yeah. Well, I played on your guys' server, but again, there was just like 4 or 5 of us on at any given time. There wasn't like a big, huge community.
And that's the thing. Right. I guess the community that I had was like there were 200 or 300 people on and off throughout the day at any given week.
Wow. I don't play Minecraft anymore at all.
No.
I don't even touch it.
Like, I jump back to it every like 6 months to a year.
Yeah.
I mean, it's been a while since I picked it up last, but it was a lot of fun as it was, but I've moved on to other things. So me and Mike were playing on a server for the game Rust.
That's a lot of fun because it's like everything I wanted to do in Minecraft but couldn't.
Isn't that the game where you can't even pick your sex, though, that you could turn out and be thrown into the game as like a...
Yeah, that's called life, Greg. That's called life.
Yeah. Well, that's the thing. I mean, like, Rust is the closest game to a, like, a pure survival game that I've ever played. Because, like, you're thrust into the world as... You're thrust into the world, confused and unsure of how to do anything.
Naked.
You're naked, confused. Holding a rock and a torch.
Yeah.
That's how you guys were born, right?
Oh, they give you a rock and a torch? That's too much.
Yeah.
You're assigned a random race and gender that you cannot change, at least for the moment being. And you have to survive on the land in a post-apocalyptic world, right?
See, right now my wife and I are playing something similar. We're playing Ark, and it's the same idea, only there's dinosaurs.
Oh, that's lame.
You get thrown into a tropical island that... is uninhabited by anyone other than vicious creatures.
So it is inhabited.
Well, uninhabited by other men. Unless you're playing on a server with other guys.
What about women? Is it only inhabited by women?
Yeah, it's Amazonian women.
Okay, yeah.
That want nothing but snoo-snoo.
Nothing but snoo-snoo?
I don't know. I have a hard time thinking of video games that, I guess, influence me.
Really?
I don't know. I used to play, like, a lot of just the standard... NES, Mario, and stuff with my dad growing up. Probably Tetris. I played a lot of Tetris. Oh my god. I remember we used to make jokes all the time. Dad and I would, like, we pack up the car for a camping trip or something, and it was like, oh, we could do it. We play a lot of Tetris.
I came home from grocery shopping once, and the only thing I couldn't get in the fridge was pizza, right? Like just one pizza, and like everything else is, like, stacked. Like, this. It's like, everywhere. I'm like, well, fuck it. I can't get this in the fridge. I might as well eat, fucking pizza for tonight. But I was amazing. Packing my car. Anytime I've had to move, I've been able to get 90% of my stuff in my car.
Doesn't sound like you were very good at Tetris, because Tetris would involve you getting 100% of the stuff in there.
Yeah. And then it disappears.
Well, the thing is, though, is like when you complete a level.
I can get 90% in there. Well, that's not winning.
Yeah.
That's
you're going to lose.
Here's the thing. Tetris is the exact opposite of what you want to happen when you're packing away groceries, because when you complete a line, your food disappears. I don't want that.
Ha ha.
Come on.
That's... Fuck, you're funny.
I thought it was funny.
You should write that joke down, tell it at parties.
So that people can not laugh at it there, too.
Yeah.
Fuck you guys.
That Greg should do parties. Okay, it's fucking funny. I don't know. I played a lot of that and like the Duck Hunt.
See, I played a lot of those
duck
games.
Hunt. I have to separate those words. I played a lot of DeCunt.
I played a lot of Nintendo. I had a Nintendo, and I played it, but I didn't really get hardcore into gaming, like, you know, sitting for long hours at a time playing a game until I started playing World of Warcraft.
Yeah, I didn't get hard until I was a teenager either.
Yeah.
Yeah. That's pretty much what I got out of that. I'm sorry.
Wow. So with WoW, I guess, did you feel any sort of sense of community, though, like with a guild?
Yeah, because at the time, I was playing it with a big group of my work friends.
Mm-hmm.
And we raided together. We did a lot of stuff together. And that was back when I was still working a night shift every once in a while. And I was allowed to bring my personal laptop to work with me.
Oh, yeah, yeah.
So I'd sit there all night waiting for a call and playing WoW.
Yeah, that was back in...
McCain's.
Oh, yeah, before we met.
Yeah.
Yeah, because I had a buddy who worked there nights, and he was telling me about that, too.
Yeah, and then someone apparently came after I left and got caught doing it, or
kind of ruined it for
ignored everyone. The queue and ruined it for everybody else.
I didn't really play any games online until I played Diablo 2. And then I was playing it over at my buddy's place. I would spend the night over there, and I think I was only, 12 years old. And, I think he got sick of the game because I wanted to play it so often.
Makes sense, yeah.
Him and his dad had two computers set up in their computer room, and I wanted to play that one nonstop. But I mean, no real, I guess, community to that, if you want to call it that.
I suppose, yeah.
Kind of got me addicted to computer games, though. I mean, my dad, dad and I used to play StarCraft.
Okay, yeah.
Yeah, yeah, the first StarCraft. Yeah. And
I played a lot of Warcraft 3. Which is the same idea.
Same idea, yeah.
No, we played a lot of StarCraft. That was a lot of fun. Space pinball.
Oh,
you remember when that was a thing?
Yeah.
Yeah, I remember when that was the shit. I remember when I'd get home from school and fucking load that shit up.
Oh, yeah.
And try to beat the high score.
I remember when my next door neighbor got their first computer. It was even before I had a computer. And we always wanted to go over there so we could play that stupid little ski game. Where you get almost like a stick man, and you're trying to ski down the hill, and then every once in a while, an abominable snowman will come and try and eat you.
Okay.
I don't know if you guys ever played that.
Oh, man, my sister and I used to play the cereal box games.
Oh, yeah.
Yeah.
All the point-and-click adventures, Freddy Fish and Pajama Sam. I remember my sister actually played the Freddy Fish game so much that our disk drive had overheated, and when she went to go open the disk tray, the disk exploded. In the tower. We had to open it up and take pieces of Freddy Fish out of there.
Poor Freddy Fish.
A few of the more memorable games, though, from the cereal boxes were Roller Coaster Tycoon.
Yep.
That was a good one.
That's it. That's where it ends.
Who Wants to Be a Millionaire?
Okay, that's true.
Tonka Truck Racing.
Pretty sure Jeopardy was one. Wheel of Fortune.
Jeopardy.
I guess I did play a lot of Monopoly.
You're a monster.
There was a Monopoly Tycoon game. There was Monopoly Tycoon,
mm-hmm.
which was a completely different style, and it was weird.
I liked it.
Yeah, I liked it too. Yeah. It was I didn't quite understand.
Oh, wasn't Risk one of them too?
I don't know. I played Risk as a board game. If you want to talk about, you know, games that influence us the most,
by all means.
Risk as a game influenced me in the sense that I got heavily into history while I was in school because of Risk. and strategy games in general.
I like strategy games, but my biggest problem with Risk is the group of guys that I would play with were always way better at it than I was.
Yeah.
So I was always one of the first ones out. And these sessions would go all night long.
Man,
I'd be stuck sitting there trying to find stuff to do while everybody else is still playing Risk.
We had sessions that went on for multiple days.
Yeah,
I remember the one that didn't, when we dressed as different dictators and world leaders, and you had to bring a bottle of liquor from the country that you were dressed as.
I think you told me about that one once before.
And just get really drunk and try to pretend to be from that country. I had a gray jumpsuit for painting, so I came as Mao.
Wow.
I'd want to go as King Jong-un.
Yeah. And you drink cognac, because it's not from North Korea, but he gets that shit imported by, the fucking truckload.
He does.
I couldn't think of a Chinese alcohol whatsoever, so I went the next closest, and I got sake.
Sake, yeah.
From Japan. Obviously, I know the difference between Japan and China, but
I would hope so.
Yeah.
So we need to do this sometime, and I've already picked my dictator.
Who's that?
I'm going to bring a blonde wig. I'm going to get some spray on tan.
Oh, for fuck's sake. You're going to drink some Bud Light.
I'm going to drink Budweiser. And I'm going to be the Trump.
Oh, that's not too bad. That's not too bad. I guess we could do current world leaders.
Yeah.
I don't know who I would be.
You kind of look like Trudeau.
Nice hairdo.
yeah, you could like sweep the hair. And
yep. So I'd bring a nice whiskey, a nice Canadian whiskey, right?
Like yep.
Rye. Like yep. A nice rye. Be good.
Yeah.
I'm okay with that.
You're thinking of something for me.
I'm trying, but it's hard.
You can't.
Well, I mean, you've already got like the reverse Hitler facial hair going on. Like, you literally, like, the only thing you don't have is like is just between like your lips right here.
Yeah.
Which is great. If you and Hitler.
Yeah, if I kissed Hitler, we would make a mustache.
That's perfect.
Not that I would kiss Hitler. I'd lean in for the kiss, and he'd be like, ooh, come here. And I'd be like, mine kiss. And then, like, we'd lean in, and I'd totally be like, kiss him. Uppercut. I'd go down in the history as the guy who
you'd
fucking.
You'd fist Hitler?
Yeah, I'd fist him. I'd go down in history as the guy harsh. Who catfished Hitler.
Oh, my God.
Straight up.
I mean.
Straight up. I want to make a mustache.
I know it's completely off topic, but talking about Hitler in the Marvel Comics continuity.
I would go
continuity.
As Khan from Star Trek.
Yes.
And I would get the Star Trek beer that they have kicking around. It's not a world leader, but fuck you.
It's a leader of worlds.
He's a destroyer of worlds.
No, what I was going to say about Hitler in Marvel Comics continuity, Captain America is the reason that Hitler had one testicle.
Wait. So anyway, the video game that influenced me the most growing up, like I said, probably Tetris.
I so like didn't teach you like think logically, you know. That,
no,
that
I just played it a fucking lot.
A lot.
He liked the pretty colors.
I used to play Kirby on my Game Boy a lot.
Yeah, I played that a lot too.
See, I mean,
Kirby's Dream Land.
I'd play the first level.
I can never. I could never get
I liked,
into Kirby.
Mario Land. It was Mario Land, right?
That was probably the first game that I 100% completed.
That was such a great game.
And then when I finally got my Nintendo 64, it was all about, you know, playing Zelda.
Oh, no, N64
Ocarina of
was
Time,
all about
Majora's Mask. GoldenEye.
Man, that came out
unless
when
I was playing
went to college.
Unless I was playing multiplayer, there wasn't a whole lot of GoldenEye.
That's what we did. It came out when I first started going to college, and there was a couple of us that had N64s. We'd always have one hooked up in the common area.
Yeah.
And we just, there was constantly people in there playing GoldenEye.
I mean, GoldenEye was like the game, though, for
multiplayer.
For multiplayer. It defined
it was
what
the first real multiplayer, like true multiplayer game that I remember playing.
Well, actually, I remember when
other
we,
than, you know, like a LAN party.
When we used to take Halo 1 and 2, and we'd have an Xbox in each room. And run the giant Ethernet cable from one room to the other and do two teams of four. And we got right into that shit. We'd close the door and we'd strategize and shit. And, like, so that was pretty big. But that was a little later on.
Oh, of course.
The Nintendo 64 was probably the most prolific thing that I. Because that was like. That wasn't like, oh, it's there. We own it. We'll play it, you know? That was like. Oh, fuck, never mind. I had a PlayStation 1 growing up.
Sure.
And our friend put the burn chip in it for us. And he used to pirate games and sell them for $5 a piece. Of course, he gave them to us for free. He was my best friend. They were our neighbors, too.
Sure.
And, well, our neighbor's neighbor. Our neighbor was a pedophile. He just stole video games. Anyway.
criminals everywhere.
So, yeah. I don't.
Wow.
Yeah. Let's not put those on the same level, though. Crash Bandicoot and Spyro the Dragon were like
Spyro.
I all of those games for the PlayStation 1, I rocked that shit. And then I beat Final Fantasy 7 on my own, and we had Legends of Dragoon. You ever play that?
Yep.
It was like a 4 disc set. It was a big game. And I remember when my dad sat down and we started playing it together, like I started like watching him play it, and then I stopped watching him play it. And then, like, after, I don't even know how long it was. It was, like, a week. Dad was like, so I beat it. I was like, holy shit.
Wow. And for this game, I mean, that's the thing. That's back when games took up that many discs.
Yeah. Okay. Now when you download, so like we had to download Elder Scrolls Online the other day, 36 gigs.
36 gigabytes? Like,
yeah, imagine back in the day, with dial-up still, you'd be downloading that for like 2 months.
Imagine, back in the day, you would just get like an 8-disc set.
Yeah.
Or more. Way more.
No, but we had a modded PlayStation 1 at 1.2, yeah. And that was when Blockbuster was still around. And we'd go rent games from Blockbuster.
That's what Buddy's dad home. Did.
Yeah.
Rent Copy it, them, burn it.
Yeah. See, I mean, we never did anything like
that. I had nightmares because my buddy showed me the first intro, or like the intro first sort of level to Silent Hill on the PlayStation 1.
Oh, thank you.
He went up into the foggy hill and down an alleyway, and there were some zombies in a bloody wheelchair with the wheel spinning, and I had nightmares about it and woke up and threw up that night. It didn't help that I was catching the flu at the time, but
yeah, sure, Mike.
No, I was, and I was having like fluish nightmares about Silent Hill. Like,
I can't say anything. I've been playing so much Ark lately that the other night I actually woke up screaming because I thought there was something jumping on me in the bed. I was like half asleep, half dreaming.
Ark's not that scary.
No, but they introduced this new dinosaur called a Pegomastrix. That's this little hairy.
It does,
looks like a cross between a bird, a dog, and a lizard.
Greg, we've all seen.
And it steals stuff from you.
The horrific.
So you'll be running along, and then all of a sudden you'll hear
pegging.
Thunk.
We get it.
And it takes something from you and runs away.
Oh, no. Do you have nightmares about the swiper from Dora the Explorer?
Yes, I do, actually. So swiper, no swiping.
Pegger, no pegging.
You guys have... Oh, no. So you guys have had dreams, though, about games that you've been playing, like, a lot of, right?
Oh, yeah.
Yeah.
Very first time I played Portal, immediately, like, the night after...
I did not think you said Portal. I'm having a lot of Freudian hearing tonight.
the game called Porno?
Yeah.
So the first time I watched Porno, I had dreams. So first time I watched Portal, or I played Portal, I beat it. I started thinking with portals in my dream.
That's right? A great game, by the way.
It's amazing.
I've never played it.
It was never meant to be like a full
best game without a story. Ever.
No, effectively,
all I know about Portal is the cake is a lie.
It's just a fun puzzle game.
It's just a really fun puzzle game.
Yeah.
And there's just so much
really well thought out mechanics.
And exactly.
Science.
Speedy thing goes in. Speedy thing comes out.
Oh, okay, cool. Now we're doing impressions of the games.
Yeah, it's terrible. But no, so like, I started thinking with portals, and like in my dreams, I was using portal guns to get around, and I'm thinking, how can I get over there? Okay. And I follow, like shoot one over here, shoot one below me, and I fly across the way. It's great! And you smile. Yeah. So anyway, like,
and then he wakes up, and he finds himself smushed up against his wall.
Basically, it's like, how did that happen?
Alex, how'd you get in the hallway? No, I actually had a... Alex, you mentioned earlier that we were playing Rust.
Yeah.
And in Rust, the first time that we ever played Rust, an airplane goes by and it drops a giant crate.
I remember.
And Alex and I run up and we're like, oh, sweet. Guns and supplies and amazing things that we couldn't find in the game. And then we hear in the background, and we look up and there's a fucking Apache helicopter coming and we're like, sweet. Airplane brought great things. What's the helicopter going to bring? And out of nowhere, the helicopter just fucking mows me down. Just shoots me down. And I was like, what the fuck?
Like, anyway. Are you okay?
Yeah, it turns out there's this helicopter that comes in. Anybody who's outside of their homes, anybody who's wearing equipment or has weapons, it'll just gun them down. And this thing's like the most powerful thing in the game. And yeah, that was a pretty horrific experience the first time. It took us... It was shocking.
Well, the best part, though, is that, like, because it's, like, mowing us down with guns. Yeah. We're like, oh, shit, get inside. It can't shoot us through the walls. And then, so we're perfectly safe.
Through the walls.
And then we, no.
It didn't just shoot us through the walls.
We heard was, okay, we're safe.
And then the wall's gone.
Walls explode.
It has rockets.
Imagine that, a helicopter with rockets.
Yep. So and then I thought, wait, I'm dead. Mike, let it kill you. And then it lets it kill him, and then it flies away because we're dead and we're nowhere nearby.
We respawn at our sleeping bags, and it turned around and just came right back. So anyway, ever since then, when I hear like a helicopter in the distance in the game, it's like, DEFCON 1, like, oh, yeah. Strip down and hide.
It bled over into the real world, though. That's the problem.
Yeah,
I stepped outside one day, heard a helicopter, I'm like, nope, immediately turned right back around, and I got inside, started taking off my shoes, and like, wait a second.
I thought you were going to say, I started taking off my pants, I realized.
I had a dream that
I don't need to do this.
I live in the woods, and I had a dream that I went into the woods, and I heard a helicopter in the background, and I was like, I gotta get home. And you know how you're running in dreams, and it's like running in slow motion. I'm running in slow motion. Helicopter's running at helicopter speed.
It's running at helicopter speed?
Yeah, just a helicopter with legs. Big, like, fucking, like, muscly, like, oiled Olympian legs, just like...
That would be a nightmare.
What the fuck? It's got a face, too.
That's great.
It's got like, human teeth. Like something from Attack on Titan.
See, playing that must really mess you up, though, because with how close we are to the base here, we get flybys by helicopters here a lot.
The problem is that I grew up in the PMQs, right? So, like, I knew, like, every single night, like, I would hear, like, the gunshots in training in the distance. I would hear helicopters that went over my house. They didn't just go in the distance. They were, like, over the house all the time for training. When that time of the year came around, and I even know the sound of like the tanks and the lavs and stuff, because they would take the guys out to do their driver's ed training, and they would take like the student military vehicles just out on the civilian streets, right? So like, I was used to the sound of tanks driving in front of my house and helicopters. So like,
it's nothing.
So very little sound like kind of bleeds over for me. But that helicopter somehow resonated with me.
That's the thing. I mean,
it scared you.
The game does a great job of creating an atmosphere for you to be on edge.
The only other game that does a better job of it, in my opinion, at least that I've played, is a game called The Forest, where basically you crash on...
I've heard of that.
You crash
made with the same engine.
I think it might be,
if not the same people.
Yeah.
It's not the same people. Actually, it's maybe the same people who made...
Oh, then it's definitely the same engine, because it looks like...
I've got the same guy who made Garry's Mod is the same guy who's behind The Forest.
Okay.
No, he's the guy who was behind Rust.
Okay.
I'm a fucking dumbass.
Okay.
But, so, the main thing about...
I don't think anybody's going to fact check us.
Probably not. The thing about The Forest is that...
I'm going to.
Jeff will.
Yeah, Jeff will.
Like, you crash in the middle of a forest.
Yeah.
The first thing that you see is a cannibal who's dragging your son away. And, of course, you're thinking, what the fuck's just happening? You then eventually wake up, there's nothing around you, and so you're just trying to find... You assume that you're trying to find your son.
Yep.
No, he's dead.
You grab an axe.
Yeah, they...
You start grabbing, you know, breaking things open, trying to find your way around.
He's poop.
He's dead. No, he's poop. And then, so you just kind of go about your business. You're chopping down trees, and then, you know, you hear birds in the background, and everything's fine. Until... You don't hear birds in the background. Everything goes silent except for your movement. And you're like, well, that's kind of weird. And you turn around, there's a fucking cannibal trying to eat your face. And like, it jumps out in front of you. And of course, there's mutant cannibals, that, you know, things that are just... They literally look like they're stitched together.
Ooh.
So like, things that are out of your nightmare. So like this eight-legged, three-torsoed fucking...
Three torsos! I would like
to be able to sleep tonight.
I wish I had three torsos.
Like, it's a terrifying game, so...
I have enough person for three torsos.
I was just gonna say, you have enough mass for three torsos.
Greg's back, so sore the fat jokes.
But no, I mean, out of any game that I've heard of or that I've played, The Forest definitely sets that atmosphere for you to be completely fucking...
The scariest game that I ever played with my friend was Amnesia. And it was just sort of scary in the fact that, like, you're totally helpless, and the whole point of the game is to get around solving these puzzles, but every time a monster comes around, you hide, because you're helpless. There's no fighting back on anything. And you become more helpless the longer you look at it, or to see where it is. You have to hide and just hope that you're not, you know, and this thing comes in, it's this big white thing with, like, a droopy, like, melty face, and... You can't look at it. So
you wound up in the game?
You can't look to see if it's there, and if you do, your vision starts to get blurred, and you move slower. And there was this one part in the game where you're in the basement, it's all flooded, and you have to jump across these crates. And if you go into the water, all of a sudden you hear a growl, you hear something running towards you, and you see the water like, but there's nothing there.
So it seems to me like
it's so terrifying. Because I remember it was the middle of the day. We had all the lights off. We had blackout curtains closed. And I was sitting behind my buddy Cody, who was playing. And we were in my apartment at the time. And he had the computer chair across the room. And he's standing at my desk. And he's running. And he's jumping across these crates. And all of a sudden he fell in the water. And he goes, "No, fuck!" And the thing ran towards him. And he flipped the fucking table. And my neighbors put in a noise complaint. And like, yeah.
Wow.
But he got so into it. He was like, ah, when it got to him, he just like instinctively just shoved.
I feel like that game is what Slender was supposed to be. Because, like, you're not supposed to look at, like, this thing that's chasing you.
Yeah.
So, but, I mean, they took it to a whole other level and, like, improved and made it a proper game.
Yeah, yeah. I don't know. I feel like that game would be fantastic. I'd love to watch somebody play that game with a VR headset.
It's been done, but No.
I don't really play a lot of scary games like that.
Neither do I. That was probably the first one.
And it's not because I scare easily. It's just I don't find that interesting. You know what I mean? Like, that doesn't entertain me to play a game like that.
That's right. I don't know. I can't really think of much. So what do we got? We got Tetris. We got Minecraft. We got World of Warcraft. So all together.
One of the most eclectic combination of games.
Yeah, I guess so. Lessons learned?
Lessons learned. If you hear a helicopter, strip down immediately.
Yeah.
Take your pants off.
Take your pants off.
Yeah.
My lesson learned is if something traces you into the water, you flip a coffee table.
Yeah, I don't know. Lessons learned, if you can't fit it, then eat it. And if you hear a helicopter, like Alex said, take your fucking pants off.
Take your pants off.
It's a helicopter.
Thanks for watching that episode of the Words Are Hard podcast, guys. Leave a comment down below of your most memorable gaming experience, the game that's influenced you the most. Don't forget to check out our social media in the description below. That's Facebook, Twitter, Instagram, Tumblr, because we've gone that far. To check out more of our stuff, don't forget to subscribe right here to get notified whenever we post stuff. And then right here should be the previous episode that we posted. And now, as always, thanks for watching. We'll see you in the next one. I may have had a stroke.